But you know you better tread carefully. Fool me twice, I'm your enemy. I'm your enemy.
I should probably start this video by clarifying there is nothing wrong with making lifestyle videos on anything, let alone writing. Kate Cavanaugh's I Write Like series introduced me to this genre and encourages everyone to try something new. Sometimes it's nice to have a peek into someone else's routine to see what works for them, to switch things up, or experience something most of us can only dream of. But after a while, those dreams can come with a fall. The writing lifestyle is one that has been romanticized from shows like Sex and the City to Hollywood that feed off of the image of the struggling artist at war with their innermost self, or the glamorous decay one might find on Instagram that is reminiscent of an Anthropology catalog. But AuthorTube has been promoting a different image, one with the clean-cut backgrounds and bright smiles, the bookshelves boasting self-published novels, and the pastel color scheme with highlighting that is all too familiar to booktubers. Maybe it's because these videos and images feel more attainable? These writers are more down-to-earth, they're mostly self-published, they've dealt with rejection and hard times and have to hustle to make it. Maybe that's why it's so easy to get sucked into the marketing schemes behind what these writers boast. Because if they can do it, so can we. And while some are transparent about where their finances actually come from, others, not so much. Maybe they are living off of their self-published works. Maybe they're living off of sponsorships. One thing is certain, they've got our attention. They were us once, after all, before the pedestal raised them up to a higher standard of living. And hey, who doesn't love a good underdog story? Who doesn't love the fabled tale of the self-published writer rejected by traditional publishers and agents who went off in stubborn pursuit of their own success? Well, did they really get this lifestyle from writing or from marketing their platforms to build an audience that would buy whatever they released without a second thought? These days, authors are told in order to sell books, they must become a brand themselves. They must represent something of interest within the community. Good books don't sell anymore. Good writing doesn't sell anymore. Why take all that time and energy to harness your craft if it's going to be ignored? Or you can start small, quick, and worry about finesse later. But what these authors don't realize is with every book they're releasing, they are opening themselves up to the public more and more. The image shifts and reputations go with it. Maybe this is why AuthorTube has been coming under scrutiny of late. Not only are there more critics jumping on the scene to point out the flaws and poor writing, but the writing isn't getting any better. Their growth seems to have stopped. So are these authors really living off their pen? Did they attain the lifestyle through more privileged means? Or did they simply choose to harness their degrees in marketing and business to teach us littlings what it takes? And what about us? Are we going down the right path? Choosing to follow in hopes of catching the tail end of some chance to win? Or are we turning into mindless sheep feeding into the very lifestyle that profits from our hopes and dreams?
I printed out this passion planner roadmap, and as I was kind of looking at my goals, I was trying to think of how I could break them down so that I can achieve them, because that's really what three-year planning or multi-year planning is all about, at least to me. I want to be paid to travel. I want to hit some kind of book list, whether that's for like critical success or commercial success. And I'd love to have enough money to own my dream home, which basically just means having like a library room, just a room full of books in my house.
Kate Cavanaugh is certainly not the first person to invent vlogging. YouTube is full of channels that promote the highlight reel of someone's day, whether it's a morning routine, beauty routine, or a family vlog. And it can be interesting to look into the life of someone else. But after a while, we start attributing our lives with a similar lens. This doesn't necessarily have to be a bad thing. Glow-up routines are remarkably influential when it comes to switching up your lifestyle. It promotes the mindset of, hey, if they can do it, so can I. While the statement is a hopeful one, reality reminds us once we begin, there is a lot of work going on behind the scenes that often isn't mentioned. And it's easy to forget that most of these videos are heavily edited to show only the highlights of someone's life, to make it more organized, more structured, and just better content all around. I was kind of surprised at the number of comments from angry people expressing their frustration about this on some morning routine vlogs when the reality is, who would want to see a hamper full of dirty laundry sitting in the background? I don't think these videos are solely meant for appearances. is, especially when they are taken every day, but it could be also an accountability factor for the ones filming. They know they have an audience depending on them. It can provide enough peer pressure to stay organized and on track, even if most of it is a front. I used to love Olivia DeAndrea's videos for her bluntness, honesty, and bravery in not stepping away from the ugly parts of a transformation process.
But when it really counts, is when you want to give up. You don't stop when you're tired. You stop when you're done. I want to be gone. I'm almost there. Coronavirus. So I'm not touching.
It's hard work to try to change your life, and it takes discipline, commitment, and a willingness to shed the coziness of old comforts. She wasn't afraid to express how much she struggled internally as well as externally and shared her story with millions around the world. She proved to us as much as herself she could become the person she wanted to be if she put in the right amount of effort and patience, and it paid off. But AuthorTube? Kind of a different story. Now, writers within the community have been releasing more and more live streams to prove they are doing the work, but if anything, these live streams feel distracting at best and promote procrastination at worst. While I understand all writers have a different pace, I believe wholeheartedly in the tough love approach. I believe that constant pats on the back for minimum word count instead of pushing yourself to go harder really takes away from the amount of work we are willing to put into a project. Now, every little bit counts, and it is possible to hit burnout going too hard, but what is harped upon relentlessly in the community is the stop-go routine that might actually be hurting the writing process rather than helping us to grow past a certain point. It starts to downsize the heavier lifting when it comes to drafting and to editing. We're so shy of putting in a word count, we don't realize that with every bit we slow down our story, it costs us in pacing, balance, and awareness for what is going on. It's not until we get into later drafts of rewriting and rereading that we remember certain subplots, characters we introduced that went nowhere, and plot holes we had forgotten about because we were so focused on the now. One of the things that has always fascinated me is how us writers procrastinate. This isn't just a sudden happenstance, but a gradual one. How many viewers watching these vlogs rise in hope at the thought of being able to write full time, or complete a book so they can have book signings, or start an AuthorTube channel in hopes of going to a writing convention and getting involved and well known in the community? Selling a book might not even be the ultimate goal here. It could be the recognition. It could be professionalism in a career. All these goals distract from the art itself. As soon as it becomes about business, our motives change, our desires change, and our writing gets the brunt of it. Common for writers in the past to also be activists, and with that comes a lifestyle of speaking, getting involved in activities, or helping people. Not all writers are drunkards or tortured with the ideas of their own minds. Some live fairly normal lives. Some live troubled lives. Like any human being, we are all unique. We all have our own routines, our own quirks, what works and what doesn't. Kate Cavanaugh has released 632 uploads as I'm writing this, all of it having to do in some part in writing, reading, and her life. Her most popular videos are the I Write Like routines that follow the writing day of a well-known author, the first of which experiments Stephen King's routine. The videos following her channel consist of mostly vlogs, writing chats, and other various routines. Whether it's a trip to Disney or the local cafe, Kate mixes it up in her vlogs so you don't feel like you're sitting in one place, and it makes the experience more of a journey than a story time. In Kate Cavanaugh's money writing and freelance video, she opens up about her fortunate situation that allowed her to start writing full time, even before she published a single book.
I used to work a corporate finance job, and that's what I did after graduating for 3 years. And then I decided that that's just not what I wanted to do. So I had also saved up from working corporate for 3 years. And so I had a backup plan. But I'm very fortunate in that my parents were happy to have me come and live with them, so I didn't have to pay for rent, which is one of the biggest expenses. So I did realize that I never wanted to really work corporate again if I could help it. And I realized that as long as I changed my expectations for what I wanted, I totally can't help it. I started writing freelance for a couple different people and companies, and I don't give advice on how to write freelance because I came into it through people I knew. So I was doing that from when I quit my corporate job up until May, and then right around May, there were several other things that were happening, and I realized that because I'm very fortunate and I'm in a position that I can do this because I don't have really any expenses, and I do still have a fairly nice kind of like safety net of savings left. This is an option for me. This isn't an option for everyone, and I do realize how lucky I am to have this, but I decided to stop taking on any more freelance jobs, and I've been focusing solely on novels now. I have given myself a deadline of February of 2020 in order to like get my novel shit together, and then I will go back to taking freelance jobs so I can make actual money.
And while this might not be the case for all of us, some people are able to get that financial freedom a little easier than others. Now, while I appreciate the context given, I'm starting to wonder if Kate didn't jump the gun a little too soon. In her video discussing a 3-year plan almost 3 years ago, Kate delves more into where she would like to get most of her finances from, explaining she doesn't wish to have one project, but rather several hustles that pull in money from multiple directions so she's not dependent on any one thing. Which would be a smart tactic, but I feel like maybe making all those things revolve around a hobby that's not really taking you anywhere outside of vlogs turns into one source of finance. It's just split over multiple forms of social media. She recently released a video about whether or not she wants a writing career, starting off the video by trying to put in her own definition of career.
So I think for the purposes of this video, we should probably define career or writing career first. That's one of the big topics, is making enough money from your writing to live off of, or making enough money from your writing and one other thing to live off of. And I think that's usually how people define career, and that the money is definitely playing a big part. It's one of those interesting things, because when I think of someone's publishing or writing career, I would look at it over the span of time, and I wouldn't personally judge in theory off of how much money they made. Like if I saw someone consistently publishing short stories in anthologies or consistently writing poems and publishing poems, you know, I wouldn't be like, well, you didn't make at least $1,000 a year, so you can't consider it a career.
A career is an occupation undertaken for a significant period of a person's life and with opportunities for progress. What is an occupation? A job or a profession? A profession is a paid occupation, especially one that involves prolonged training and a formal qualification. Job is a paid position of regular employment. Therefore, a career is something that you must receive some monetary compensation for over a period of time. Otherwise, it belongs to the hobby category.
I don't think I've talked to a single person yet where they were just a full-time author. So far, even the ones who are USA Today bestselling authors or had a traditional publishing contract doing other jobs or have multiple careers, their writing is the side hustle. But even the people who were making enough from their writing to do it full time for a while couldn't pull that off for the long run. Wanting it is just not enough, right? The thing with art is that even actively pursuing it and trying your hardest is not a guarantee that's gonna happen, right? If the goal is a monetary goal, there really is no guarantee. It really doesn't matter how hard you worked. You know, obviously hard work is part of it, but there's so much about luck and timing. And is what you love to write and what you're good at writing, is that marketable? Because it might not be. Sometimes it doesn't matter how wonderful a writer you are or how adored and how they devour your books, because you have like a much lower ceiling versus these books that we think of, the kind that get turned into movies or blockbusters or something, right? Obviously, this isn't to say that people can't do it. We have tons of examples on AuthorTube of people doing it. When I first quit my corporate job, I had a much different definition. I had sort of the classic idea of I will make money exclusively off my writing and I will be able to live off of my writing, and that was my goal. After a few years of trying that, I kind of realized that attempting to make money solely off of that was just a bad idea. It was just not for me. So I do think a big part of the reason that I don't want to pursue writing alone as my only means of income is because it is so difficult. My goal is, or how I'm currently living, I guess I should say, is this hodgepodge of income together from a bunch of different sources, right? An actual struggle of what's making me money now versus what I'm working on now that has the potential to make me money in the future versus things that I want to do that I know are not marketable and not commercial and likely would never make me much money, but take the same amount of time. You know, that's the thing about, we've spoken before, there's no way to know for sure. Even if you follow all of the advice, there's no guarantee. It does not matter how hard you work, and that it is not a guarantee. It of course matters how hard you work, so that you can create the best possible thing, right?
I guess there's some debate on what makes a writer's career versus a lifestyle choice, but the only writing I've seen of Kate's is on her website where her blog is concerned. And that's fine. Plenty of writers can make a living doing most any type of writing. You don't have to be a novelist and you don't have to be published under someone else to make it. These days, it's easy to start your own website, YouTube channel, or to self-publish your work. But Kate's latest video has me wondering if she isn't in a bit of a rut. Did she ever actually intend to make a living off of writing that wasn't merely about documenting the process? Because she states in her 3-year plan that she expresses the want to get paid for travel, speaking, Discord, and the basic platform of what would be known as the modern influencer. Not necessarily the modern writer. I think she did intend to publish a book. I just don't know if she realized the amount of work that was going to go into it, and I think personally she might have hit burnout. Now, if I'm right about this, it would explain why her writing on her channel only seems to go so far. She started querying Project Blue a few years ago and talked about her fear of rejection, among other things, but every writer knows this is part of the process. It's a necessary part of the process, as is rejection. Even the greats had to endure rejection after rejection, some struggling to pay bills along the way, others throwing their soon-to-be career in the trash. And while it's not an easy thing to endure with the platform she has on YouTube, it wouldn't be hard for her to sell her debut novel to a waiting audience through self-publishing. She already has a decent following, and one release could set her up for a modest salary for 1, maybe even 2 years. I think a lot of people would cut her even more slack because she's more of a vlogger than an instructor, and keeping track of her progress and pitfalls is why people fell in love with her in the first place. The hustle is a term defined by moving hurriedly or unceremoniously in a specified direction, or to obtain by forceful action or persuasion. Many of us have become acquainted with some form of the modern-day hustle, the go-go-go routine that encourages everyone to quit that job, to live your dreams, simply by grabbing hold of life and shaking it until it starts raining $100 bills. Ads pop up on the daily wherever you go online about someone who made it, who bought that Lamborghini, who made a living off of making a living. People on Instagram hashtagging live your best life while bragging about how easy it is to get paid traveling. All the while withholding the real secret to their success. They've either got connections, they're running a scam where you get to foot the bill, or they're using a trust fund. But my favorites are the ones who tell you that if you just want to be successful and rich like them, to buy their program. All the while not really specifying how they made their money, just that they did, and you can too by doing the following things. Make the bed, wake up early, start journaling. I do find it a little ironic that Kate is giving this kind of advice before her career had technically taken off, even before her YouTube channel took off, and then we find out later she had saved up from her previous career and took freelance by living with her parents. But that's not strange for AuthorTube. Most of the people making videos on here do portray an image, and then I feel like they later clarify on what they're actually living off of when people start asking questions. This kind of reminds me of the writing classes, the workshops, the odds and ends that feed into the planning mentality behind what the AuthorTube has already set up for success. Now, planners are writers in their own right. They do things differently than pantsers, but I can't help but wonder if the reason most of AuthorTube has revolved itself around planning is to sell a product, and I don't mean just books. You can go to Staples, Target, Office Depot, hell, even the dollar store to buy post-its and a corkboard, whiteboard, binders, all the office supplies you might need to plan out a manuscript. There is writing software online like Scribner and Dabble that aid in setting up your world building, plotline, characters, etc., etc. You don't actually need any of the products being sold here, but the way they're marketed kind of makes the process look more fun, easier, and maybe it is. Maybe it's just the critic in me being suspicious that so much of the writing community isn't about what makes a good story, but about what you can do to plan and plot to death an idea that might be burnt out before you even sat down to start writing. These products aren't the only things being sold. Writing classes and courses offer little more than the advice videos you would find on YouTube and repackaged snippets of Save the Cat burst on the scene as soon as these writers discovered it. There are a good number of writers who are honest about their finances and admit they couldn't really gather a sole income from one source but have to divide it among others, and I think these products are still bringing in a portion of something. Some writers offer editing services for a fee, whether qualified or not. Some have a Patreon to play additional videos and tips and tricks. Some sell planners and writing courses, candles and stamps, and with more and more that is released, the more the community starts to take away from the writing itself to place a spotlight on these shiny packages they're producing for consumption. I believe AuthorTubers are YouTube creators first, writers second. Even though writing is a focal point of their channel, most of the time it feels like the act of doing it is more of a prop to affirm a certain label and the motivation behind their YouTube consistency. As is pretty evident when we get to see them moving on to light and life advice, travel vlogs, or stamp collections. Don't misunderstand, writers still need to make money. We have bills to pay. But the marketing behind the books for these writers would suggest that products should come before the art, and I think that is what a lot of people are conflicted about. While I could get into the difference between art and business and the mixture of the two on the spectrum, I only have so much time for this video, but I will be diving more into that subject another time relatively soon. Why I wanted to bring this up is to point out the uncanny comparisons behind motivational speakers, life coaches, and online entrepreneurs to that of AuthorTube marketing. Companies in all forms of entertainment have been selling more and more products that feed into our emotions and nostalgia. Marketers everywhere have learned how to tap into the human psyche to sell products using vibrant colors, pounding music, or name-dropping celebrities just to get them in the theater. Hell, fast food companies have specialized scientists to figure out the chemical compound trigger that will not only manipulate a person's chemistry into eating more food, but craving it. The writing community also uses vibrant colors and bright contrast, painted smiles, and they hop on the latest trends to keep up with what's new. We give off a polished professional demeanor even if we haven't finished writing our debut novel, let alone published one, and persuade new writers on the scene that our advice is bomb. But that bomb seems to drop whenever someone reads their latest work to find out they're not even following their own advice. It's just business. And while I think it's important to market your book to a certain degree, the same tactics being used are those that would align with modern-day corporations using half-truths and manipulation rather than sharpening their skills to create a higher quality product. Now, I recognize the right-to-market fiction tactics that are used on the spectrum, and I'm not completely against it. Even AI can create beautiful pieces of art that inspire further artists. It's not all glum and gloom, and it's not all sterile gray rooms with little inspiration. Some writers use tropes, cliches, and favorite plotlines to reform their stories, and some do it to sell and make money. Some of them have honed their skills to do it beautifully, differently, and learn the tactics needed to catch the eye of a certain fan base. More and more writers are popping popping up on the scene, and it's getting harder to stand out. It's harder to find something that speaks to us. It's harder to find better quality books to learn from because structures and fundamentals are being tossed aside for pandering points. You can learn much from the poor examples, but it means little if there are no better examples to compare. Placing one's prime focus on raking in money for profit to live that freelance career you're drooling over erases everything that it means to be an artist. It's not easy being a writer. For most, it's even harder making a living as one. Writing isn't always the glamorous, well-to-do lifestyle it is often portrayed as. I think many of us on social media get carried away with the reputation we want to have, the image we want to portray, and have some control in how people see us. AuthorTubers aren't the only ones who put on a show. Many of us use the highlight reel to showcase moments in our life that make it seem like everything is going great while hiding behind the hard truth. We're all in some bit of struggle. Success isn't a guarantee, especially in the writer's world. Some of us have no idea how we're actually doing, and others have to get around to writing full-time by doing other things full-time. It's easy to compare your life to that of someone online, but I think it is important to remember that they do have their moments and that everyone has a different life, a different routine, and different obstacles to face, especially when it comes to writing. The journey is long, hard, and arduous. It takes failure upon failure upon failure to think we're finally starting to get it right, only to be hit in the face with reality once more through negative feedback, analytics, and sales numbers. The Guardian released an article discussing the plight of Louis Candlish and Carrie Hudson struggling to repeatedly break the cycle of midlist writing. There is no safety net, Hudson expresses after having won the French Prix Femina for her novel Thirst, after she applied for a grant for help with the next payment on her rented sublet flat in the UK. Candlish says, it's just so hard for a midlist, mere-career writer to break the cycle. So much of the pot is given to hype debuts and established household names. You really are as good as your last sales figures. I've often been in situations where I've literally been scrabbling around for coins in the back of my sofa the week before getting some good news. Midlist writers are the ones who haven't made the bestseller list, but they help run the publishing market by selling marketable works similar to ones that have been done before. We can only have so many literary stars at a time, and midlist writers help fill the gaps in between while we wait for that next big thing. And while a lot of writers might dream of lake houses, publishing contracts, TV interviews, and millions waiting for our next release, some of us dream of a more realistic, attainable goal, to do what we love and live a good life. Self-publishing has definitely helped in this regard, aiding writers who were otherwise hobbyists to start publishing their works to see how they would do and then have that option to make a full-time career of it or keep going at their own pace. However, with more and more writers coming on the scene, the market for self-publishing has also begun to get saturated. Cheryl Connor wrote in an article with the Forbes where she says, author Winslow Elliott has pointed out some sobering facts. According to a survey conducted by Bowker in 2002, the total number of books published was 247,777. 8 years later, it's 4,134,519. Professional writers would be fools to ignore the competition. Being good isn't good enough. Building a solid platform, standing out from the crowd, getting subjects and presentation right, and being successful at networking and promotion are just a portion of what it takes to enter the publishing game. And when you have been published, you need to be successful at selling yourself. From what I've seen, that number isn't going down. Barrett Kohler Publishers report, nearly 1.7 million published books were self-published in the US in 2018, which is an incredible 264% increase in just 5 years. By 2019, the total number of books published in the US exceeded 4 million that year alone, including both self-published and commercially published books of all types, according to date provided by ProQuest. I recently watched the Naughty Books documentary on Hulu, where authors like Kelly Mayne, Kristen Proby, and CJ Roberts talked about how their career in smut fiction romance took off soon after 50 Shades of Grey. This market is by far one of the more popular genres in fiction writing, at least since 2010. While stories like these may get a lot of views, their following tends to fluctuate. Writers in the documentary talk about their burst of success followed by a career some of them didn't even know they wanted, and then finally the anxiety of eyeing the Amazon bestseller rankings as they wait to see whether or not their works will rise or drop. Some of them hit burnout, lost their love for writing, others express their discontent in having to write far outside their comfort zone to hold the attention of an audience that craves darker, more violent types that take away from the romantic and emotional aspect their stories seem to have started with. Whether you're going into traditional or self-publishing, many facets remain the same. We do need to market ourselves, we do need to market our books, and we need to set up our own careers. We have plenty of tools at our disposal through social media, but like many influencers, writers tend to see what appears successful and follow suit, not realizing they might actually be what's holding them back. There are so many readers out there and so much material to choose from. So I guess the real question is, how are we supposed to stand out? While it may be difficult to become a writer or have a career in that field, it's not impossible. There are plenty of hopeful and helpful stories online that share how they found success through discipline, dedication, and tactics they thought would benefit their brand. Heartbreathings, for instance, gives an open account to her tactics and how she decided to appeal to her audience through a form of what I like to call chain writing fiction, which lets one story bleed into the next and lead the writer to crave more by the end of the book. She also goes into how she fell victim to the trap of following the numbers and trying to do too much at once to keep up, but by the end of it, she learned that none of it means anything if you're not enjoying what you're writing. Maybe the marketing plan shouldn't be to appeal to a certain number of people. Maybe the focus shouldn't be on creating a large audience. Rather, seeking out the audience that your work speaks to, that they can enjoy. Creating a form of writing and working on skills to create a better quality product that will bring readers back. Maybe this would cure the whole debut novel epidemic writers seem to fear, that the first release has to be the end-all be-all for their career, when of course your debut novel is going to sell the most. That doesn't mean it's going to appeal to everyone. Consistent releases will help hold on to that audience that comes back for more of what they like to see. And even then, it isn't going to be a permanent thing. People change, moods shift, one person might like your type of story one day and a few years later look back like, I really enjoyed that. So what do we do? While I believe firmly in marketing your book to a certain degree, I think our focus on getting that right to live lifestyle will not only prove as a distraction, but decrease the quality of life we're living now. Envy can hold you back in more ways than one, but the biggest would have to be enjoying life to the fullest no matter what process you're currently in. Doing the work is necessary to get that reward. Influencers have it all wrong. This isn't about quitting that job to go spend your savings in Tahiti. It's about living for even the smallest moments, to create memories that carry you through even the hard times and remember why life is worth living. Create a balanced routine that keeps you from feeling burned out, but retain that discipline to make every second count, even the work you're putting in, until you've realized you reached that end goal. Like any relationship, that of the writer and their work takes work to keep it constant. Sometimes the only answer is patience, discipline, and consistency. Writing anything, especially anything longer than 50,000 words, requires a lot of patience. You can't rush it or the work will feel unfinished. You can't avoid it or it will never get done. And when you look down on your finished product, you won't hate it for being the thief that may or may not provide you with the life you want. Rather, it's something you can be proud of, and you should be. Those experiences have an effect on your perspective, your understanding, and help strengthen your creative abilities. That is what changes your writing. Otherwise, time will feel like it is being swallowed whole by work and wanting, and that will become the destroyer of your life rather than the reward.